Last time on Dice Funk.
Yeah, so you guys didn't want to be in Aeron's experiment, so he went to Luna, and Luna thinks his experiment is going to help him be immortal.
Thanks, Reese.
Ed is unconscious.
He summons up what little power he has left and uses a torrential spout of blood to blast Ed off the stage, and he slams into the wall, crumples into a heap on the floor.
Every part of you needs to disappear from this world. And then she's going to drive her sword through the neck of that creature.
Then I want to throw a pew at Big Luna.
You squash his brain out of his eye hole as you shove a pew inside his head.
I will say that any attempt to heal Ed will result in him not coming to for the time being.
Raises for everyone who fought here today.
At some point, everyone's going to have to deal with the fact that Alistair's going to come back and take back control of administration.
Where's Ed?
Is he not in your body?
Who decides who is rich and who is poor? Who decides what you deserve? Within this, Valentine itself, there lay a vault, the soul of your city.
So we have to steal a whole city. Cash rules everything around me. Green, get the money. Dollar bill, yo. I grew up on the crime side, the New York Times side. Staying alive was no job, had second hand. Moms bounced on old men, so then we moved to Shaolin land. A young youth, you're rocking the go-to. Low goose, only way I begin to G-York was drug loot. And let's start it like this, son. I had a tweet the other week go over 4,000 retweets, and oh my goodness, my phone, it wouldn't last more than like 3 hours. I had to uninstall Twitter because it was just buzzing.
Yeah, at that point, you might as well just throw it in the lake. It's fucked.
My little sister, actually, she attended the Mets game that happened the past week where the Mets lost like 4-25 or whatever, and it was on her birthday. So she had like a 4-part picture story to it that has been picked up by like every Mets outlet out there.
Oh, God.
So she doesn't know how to deal with it. I think it's like 8,000 retweets right now. She's become a meme. She's not dealing with it very well. It's a good time.
I had that one time I had a YouTube video that went over like over 1 million views. That was weird. Didn't like that. No, please.
How does anybody deal with it? Like, we have a pretty like modest audience, and sometimes I'm just like, I can't right now. There's too much feedback. It's killing me. I have to log off.
Yes.
What if I was just famous? I wouldn't last a day.
Big mood.
Oh, boy.
Well, you're not famous because you're not SoundCloud tweeting after your tweet went viral, Austin. That's why. They go part and parcel.
I can't deal with the pressure. I'm fragile. I'm a fragile baby.
Now that we've all been defeated, should we do some D&D?
Yeah. All right. On the last episode, Aeron revealed his experiment. I'm just going to talk like this for the whole finale arc.
In the middle of the desert is Valentine itself. Two cities stacked on top of each other, floating in the air. And a sandstorm is rolling in. You guys emerge from the tunnels up to the subway platform in North Valentine, because you're going to have to get in a vehicle and ride across the desert to get there to stop someone else from claiming whatever is in the vault that Aeron says holds the soul of Valentine. That's probably not ominous, especially because you know Luna was in league with him in some way.
Yep.
So that's where we'll start. You guys emerge, blinking into the sunlight. You see in the distance the sandstorm is rolling in. This is actually a weird recording coincidence because between recordings, there was actually a huge haboob in Arizona. Yeah, chuckle it up.
I forgot about that word. Fuck you.
Listen, it's a great word. But the pictures coming out of Arizona were exactly what I had in my mind, which is just this wall of like red sand as far as the eye can see in every direction, and it's just moving towards the city. And people kind of knew it was coming. It's coming a little earlier than they expected, but you know, they knew. They've lived here for a while, so they're running, you know, they're closing up their shops, you know, putting tarps down and all that kind of stuff. It's a weather thing. Like in Florida, you're like, it's hurricane season. You gotta board the windows. So.
Oh man. Hurricane fucking season. Fuck.
Yeah. So the city is going into lockdown as you guys emerge. What do you do?
I just have like a question about Valentine itself from a distance, just in terms of trying to picture it myself. Are we talking like South Valentine is on the level of the desert, and then above that is North Valentine, and then, like, are they connected? Is there, like, some physical way to get up to North Valentine in this weird floating situation?
You know those, like, apple cores where you can, like, cut out the core of an apple?
Yeah.
Imagine someone did that around the entire city, like, around North Valentine, down through the ground to all the bottom of South, and then pulled it out of the ground, and then moved it into the desert, and just kind of stuck it in the middle of the desert.
Okay, so we're not going to have to work out some way to, like, fly up to the city above the first city or anything.
No, presumably you would go... First of all, you can't see it from here. It's in the sandstorm. But when you get to it...
Okay.
I'm just going to tell you now, it's floating a couple inches off the ground. So you'll have to, like, approach it and, like, climb into one of the tunnels in South. Go up through the... It's the final dungeon is what's happening.
Okay, okay.
And then you'll have the dungeon crawl up through South to get to North.
I just thought, while we were on the way there, should I be brainstorming ways to get up to a city that's floating too high to reach? But that's cool, okay.
It's just that the whole city's in the air. Like, not in the air, but you know what I mean, like...
A copy of the city, I just want to be clear, the regular city's...
Okay, because I wasn't sure, I was like, it's a copy, and then you're like, it took it out of the ground, and I was like, wait.
I was like, imagine. The real one? Imagine that. So the regular city is still exactly where it's always been. The copy, okay. Valentine itself, is out there in the desert inside the sandstorm.
Okay.
Okay, so the only other question I have quickly is, I can't remember because we recorded very late last time. How did we get that message from Aeron?
It was like streaming it to everybody, right?
Okay, it was streaming on the TV, so we weren't physically anywhere near Aeron.
No, he streamed it out to everybody, and in fact, people, you see, like, cars zoom by, like, full of drunk dudes with guns who are all going out there. It's like, he said there's a vault in the desert, and it has some crazy thing in it, and also I'm a famous guy who's, like, shooting rockets into space. Everyone knows me. I'm a big guy. Come out and try to get my vault. So it's like, all of the ne'er-do-wells are going out there for this.
Is this, like, a mashup of, like, Borderlands 1 and 2 into just a single thing here now?
No, it's Dice Funk Season 4 Valentine.
Oh, okay. I
like that. Just... Similar to that.
There's story, so it can't be the first Borderlands.
Oof. Fucking got him. Take it, Randy Pitchford. You're not going to magic your way out of this one.
So I'm voting we all just, like, get in the van and start driving, because time seems of the essence here.
Yeah, let's just... Put on some tunes and go.
Time is extremely of the essence. So two cars pull up, because when you say you get in the car, I assume you mean you call the car. One car has Handsome Chris, who pulls up. And
oh, love him.
He's in his own personal car. And the other car is the Losermobile, driven by Bloodmaw, the Invincible, the demon. So they bring two cars, because they don't know what's happening.
I'll go with Bloodmaw. He's big.
The Losermobile seems like... It has a better chance of surviving what might end up being a very Mad Max-esque situation trying to drive to the place where all the valuable thing is.
Hey, Bloodmaw, I killed a god.
Reese will turn to the rest of the party and she's going to say, good luck, you guys. I don't think I can go on this one.
Okay.
Are you going to be... Okay. Like, things seem like they're going down a little bit.
I know. I just can't go on another adventure and kill people. It's just... There's a threshold, and I've crossed it. I killed, like, 1,000 of my best friends back there. Good luck, you guys. Like, a big thumbs up.
All right. Mad respects.
So Handsome Chris, who's getting out of his car, he assumed that Bloodmaw was going to give you guys the vehicle and then he's going to drive Bloodmaw back to the courts. But as he hears Reese say this, he says, I got Alistar on line 3. Do one of you guys want to deal with this or Reese help?
Reese will just grab the phone back. I got it.
Okay. Chris jumps back in the driver's seat. He's going to go back.
Yes, I do.
You bastard. You did this to me on purpose. All right, so actually, well, wait, hold on. In retrospect, I totally did it to myself.
I was going to say, you made Handsome Chris.
I tried to blame it on you. It was me the whole time. Okay, Chris is going to go back to... my brain just exploded. Handsome Chris is going to go back to administration with Reese, who is ducking out of this mission.
Reese, just remember, we have all the power right now, so, like, don't give an inch.
Chris, it was nice podcasting with you. See you later. Bye.
Yep. Goodbye.
Slam.
I know that was me leaving.
Chris will be replaced by Scotia.
That's my disembodied voice from afterwards that I left on a recording to explain.
Oh, this. Chris is gone. Great. Okay, now I have so much trash I want to talk about.
Yeah, we can really get into the show now that Chris is gone and definitely not about to play a different character for this arc.
No, put Scotia on the mic.
Why is he so muscly?
Yeah, exactly. What? How does he get away being so handsome and muscly? I mean,
we don't need someone this handsome on the show. That's just taking away from the rest of our attractiveness.
This is so self-indulgent. We're 10 minutes in.
Put Scotia on the mic.
She's very scared. It's raining here right now, so she wouldn't be very good mic material.
Protect her.
Oh, she's good. She's just a wuss dog.
Same.
Chris, what are you doing?
I'm sitting here listening. Oh, you mean what I'm doing otherwise. I'm going to be playing Bloodmaw, the Invincible, since I'm not playing Reese right now.
I knew that before we started recording. This is not a surprise to me.
Okay, well, you said, what am I doing? I told you. I thought this was for the audience.
Wow.
Yeah, it is.
Okay. All right. Sup, audience.
All right, so what's Bloodmaw's deal?
Well, he's Bloodmaw, the Invincible. Mm-hmm. He's a professional wrestler who shoots blood everywhere. And mechanically, he's a level 10 barbarian. And he's a big, strong, burly boy. He's got a lot of strength, a lot of constitution. Not so good in the mental stuff, but he doesn't need that because he's just here to beat up people and be muscle, essentially.
Canonically, he loves sandwiches.
He does love sandwiches. That's actually listed as his flaw on my character sheet.
I like Chris's strategy for making sure that he's got a character that survives this season, which is just play all the characters. If you play three characters, one of whom is called the Invincible, you probably have one survive the campaign.
If Bloodmaw dies, I'm playing Handsome Chris, so it's gonna be rough things after that because he doesn't have any stats.
Yeah. All right. So, Bloodmaw, do you say anything to the group? Because you just got out of the Losermobile. You saw Reese peace out, and everyone's like, all right, guess we're going to drive into the sandstorm and fight every bad guy in the entire city fighting over a vault.
You puny humans need help upon your mission to devour the Blood God.
No, I already did that.
I have no opposition.
How about conquering the Sand God?
Okay, let's do that.
Hey, if you want to punch a lot of stuff, come with us. Go, go, go.
It would be tough to do either of those things, Bloodmaw, since, well, now officially there are no more gods, you know.
All are puny mortals to Bloodmaw. Gods are mortals, too.
Oh, my God.
Yes, yes, they have been. They have been for a while. I saw it when it happened. Anyway.
Get in the van! Get in the van! Get in the van! Get in the van!
Who's going to make the driving check?
I want to do the driving check.
Before we go, Bloodmaw's going to be like, I have no weapons on me. And he's going to go over to a stop sign, and he's going to clutch it with two hands and just heave it out of the ground with a huge slab of concrete on the end. And he'll be like, this shall do. And he's going to toss it in the back of the Losermobile.
Jesus Christ.
Okay. Oh, straight up and down D20 for driving roll. Frank got a 19.
Dang.
Hell yeah. Frank, you peel out of the subway station in the Losermobile. Team Loser, you guys are still a little beat up, but I assume you healed with short rests.
Is this the only good driving roll we've had all season?
No. There's a couple really
Skitch
good ones.
Skitch got a crit, didn't he?
It's the only good one Frank's had.
Yeah.
I think it's the only one above a 10 Frank's had.
Reese did one that was so good she did a flip.
That's right.
All right, so you guys head out of Valentine and into the desert. Valentine itself is dead center. In fact, you know exactly where it is because it's where you met Aeron three episodes ago, where he put the Ironsoft in the middle of the desert. It is all the way out there. So up ahead of you, you guys see the sandstorm rolling in. It's bearing down on you, and you guys start to see other cars ahead of you. Everyone's just in a mad race to get to Valentine itself. Do you guys talk about anything on the way or do anything? It's your last chance to prepare before we basically start crawling through this dungeon.
And pass Bloodmaw the blunt.
Bloodmaw takes it, and we'll eat it.
This is a disgusting sandwich! It tastes nothing of the roasted flesh of turkey.
You know, even if it's not, like, fully decarbonated, if you eat a lot of weed, it's still gonna get you high like an edible, right?
Jesus.
Do demons get high?
Let me check. Hold on, I have the monster manual here.
Do demons get high?
That'd
be great if it says, if the actual D&D official book says, yes, Lauren, they do.
I hope so.
Condition immunity is poisoned, so I don't think
is
they
that
can
the
get
the same thing?
Listen.
All inebriation is basically low-level poisoning.
Fair.
Yeah.
Damn. You got me this time, Blood Ma.
Would you like half of Blood Ma's turkey sandwich?
Fuck yeah. All right. Cats love turkey.
Aw. Cats are good.
So sharp.
Blood Ma's good.
I'm going to use, if we're doing a short rest, I'm going to do Arcane Recovery to get back two spell slots.
Gonna need those.
Yep.
I can imagine Blood Maw reads, like, for some reason, the loser opiel is like an airplane where it has, like, safety guides and, like, the seat pocket in front of him. And he's just quietly flipping through them before angrily ripping it apart and be like, safety is for losers!
All right, as you say that, you guys see...
Oh, I can only hope I set things off by saying that.
Yes, that was the code word. You have activated Ragnarok.
Oh, yeah!
No. You guys see, basically, across from you in the desert, a magical sigil appear in the air, a glyph with all kinds of arcane symbols. You've seen this exact glyph before, several arcs ago, and from this glyph... comes first a large military vehicle with a minigun on top, and then a brand new shiny muscle car.
Is it Algernon?
No.
No.
Oh. Oh, well, because I thought that the Sharps got military, so I just assumed Algernon would get a car, go out with them. I don't know. Listen.
Yeah, it's Pond and Booker, so...
You are right. The fact that we didn't buy military is now... This is a consequence. We are facing our choices.
Can you see my logic, though?
Pond, Booker, and the Inevitable come out of...
Oh, I hate that guy.
The same portal glyph they did last time, because the live stream went out all over the world, and everyone knows there is a vault with something very valuable in it here. And so they burst out. The whole group of them, the military vehicle you guys have seen before, that was the only surviving vehicle of that car chase. Pond has a brand new shiny muscle car, and the Inevitable, which if you'll recall is almost like a kind of a super powerful mechanical angel. They are like the highest power left in Mechanus, the lawful neutral plane. And that thing is flying without flapping its wings, just under some kind of magical power. And they're across from you in the desert, going in the same direction you are.
I really want to throw the fucking Inevitable with my Magneto powers, but I don't want to start shit.
No, do it! Start shit!
Yeah.
They ain't gonna be afraid to start shit. Throw the Inevitable at the car.
Well, yeah, I don't want to start shit if they're not starting shit, because we can conserve our... I only have two spell slots!
I mean, we can deal with them when we get there, or deal with them now, if we have to deal with them,
okay.
So...
That is...
Maybe we should check to see if they're antagonistic? This is a Blood Maw saying this. He wants more blood for the Blood God, but...
Can we like, can we insight if they're likely to attack us on the way there?
It boggles my mind that we don't get more insight rolls on this show, which is all about people interacting.
Well, 4. Frank has no clue what's going on.
I botched!
All right, so the botch is going to be very bad for you guys. Let me think here.
Lenora rolls down the window and flips him off. So,
yeah, I mean, the most interesting thing here is Lenora, you botch. So you actually, you look over, you see them come out, and you just immediately panic, and you use your power. I'm going to say that's, you botch. We need to have an interesting consequence of that, and your idea was cool. So just do your idea, because you now you think it's a good idea.
Charisma strength contest, right?
Your charisma, my strength.
Oops.
Yeah, that's a big oops.
No.
6 to 13. All right, so you try to use your conduit of magnetism to shove the Inevitable into the cars?
No, I'm not trying to throw him, just like toss him aside. Like he's like a balled up piece of paper.
Not.
I just don't like him. I hate him.
I know. It's just your word choice. I don't want to throw him. I just want to toss him. Like,
I love it. Not like throw him on the cars, but you know what I mean.
The audience might not. Anyway, you failed that contest, so you try to shove him, and what happens is he does a sweet flip in the air.
Oh.
And the Harker's goons, if you will, the people from Ed's backstory he used to work with, change their trajectory to intercept you guys in the desert. Let's have another desert car battle, but this time inside a sandstorm as you guys hit the wall and you are plunged into a terrifying maelstrom. Roll initiative.
3.
Boop. 10.
Oh, I crit. 22.
Nice.
19 for Mardis.
10.
All right, Lenora, you're up first. You got a free thing by taking the initiative attacking, and then you won the initiative roll.
All right. I think I'm going to try and use my magnetism power again.
Mm-hmm.
I want to try and crash the cars into each other.
All right.
Fingers crossed. 23.
13.
Fuck you.
So they're humans inside. What happened was basically you used your magnetism to shove one car into the other, and they, with their human strength, tried to turn their wheel to avoid it. They failed miserably. This muscle car goes skidding across the desert and slams into the military vehicle with the gun on top. And because they were going 100 miles per hour in the center of a desert storm, they both go flipping end over end and basically get sucked up into the maelstrom. At which point the inevitable goes flying after them. You have destroyed two combatants.
Oh, cool.
Ed, your turn.
So what happens to the two vehicles that were taken out so far? Which ones were they?
I mean, there's only two vehicles. Well, you don't know yet. What happened was two cars going extremely fast were hit by a force. I don't know if you've ever seen what happens when that happens.
Yes, I've seen. I know what happens.
IndyCar, the NASCAR.
Yes.
It's not something people usually survive, but who knows? It's very bad. They've gone flipping, but we're in bullet time, basically.
Are you going to do anything with the inevitable, or do we just ignore the inevitable and just keep
and
driving?
Keep going.
Because it apparently went after the crashed cars.
I like the phrase, do we ignore the inevitable? It has layers.
I mean, you could say, you could tell Frank to follow the wreckage, or not the wreckage, but the cars that went going. We'd say we follow the inevitable as your action.
Yeah. All Mardis will do is point in the direction of the two vehicles that are flipping and say,
we got to go over there and check on them.
Okay, Frank's going to start driving that way, but he's going to do so very, very cautiously of, is the inevitable going to start firing on us?
All right, it's enemy's turn. The inevitable catches the two cars, one in each arm, because it is supernaturally powerful, and it basically slams its arms through the bottom of the cars, wielding them like Hulk gloves that you might get at Walmart. One has a minigun on the top, and the other opens up its grill and reveals a shiny new flamethrower. And now you guys are fighting an inevitable, which has cars for arms, which are armed with guns. That's really dope. Fight me.
Part of me wants to leap out of the car at it, but that feels like a dangerous move with us all going so fast.
You're going extremely fast in the middle of a sandstorm that strips flesh from bone. I love it.
I feel like that's not a good move, though, since I have no way to guarantee where I'll land, and I don't have wings or anything to fly with. I mean, we're already in impaired visibility, but why not add on to it? I didn't add anything onto my sheet, but can I just vomit out a geyser of blood at the inevitable's face?
I mean, it's a trick. It's like the red mist. It's a wrestling thing.
That's
You'll have to hurt yourself.
That's fine. How much damage do I need to take?
Let's say 10% of his health.
10%? That's a lot, actually, for me, but still, I'll do it. Now I'm going to spray blood at his face, at the inevitable's face.
All right, walk me through this.
All right. So, does anyone have, like, a knife or anything like that?
I have claws. And I also have a dagger glove, honestly.
Well, dagger glove will help. I just need to borrow the knife for a quick second.
Sure.
So that I can slash the inside of my mouth, basically.
Jesus Christ.
okay.
Sure.
And then I want to, like, climb onto, the top of the car, and I want to spit my blood mist at the inevitable's face.
This is extremely good. All right, so here's what's going to happen. We're in the middle of a sandstorm. I don't think this would actually work, but let's just say Bloodmaw is so practiced at this, her years of wrestling, this red mist move, that you just nail him right in the face, and he has reduced visibility for, let's say, a turn before it gets wiped away. But that'll give you guys a fighting chance.
And then I'll be on top of the car, so if we get closer to him, I could just melee attack him.
Yeah, I mean, you guys are driving along. The inevitable is still going towards Valentine itself. It's Lenora's turn.
Wow, I really put us in it this time, guys. I'm still trying to conserve spell slots for now, because I don't also want to blight the two humans if they're still in the cars.
Yeah, I mean, you see Pond and Booker. They're in the driver's seats of their respective vehicles, and they're holding down the fort.
Okay, so yeah, I don't want to like just murder them in one shot. That'd be shitty. But I hate the inevitable, so I'm gonna toll the dead on him. So wisdom save.
Ooh, wow, a lot of wisdom, huh?
Oh fuck, that's right. He's so wise.
16.
My spell save is 16.
All right, so he doesn't take any damage.
Nope, but he does hear his phone ring.
So you try to cast a damaging spell on him, it does not work, and the inevitable just says, "Oathbreakers!
Suck my dick!"
No!
We never made an oath not to fight you. We're not oathbreakers.
How far away is the inevitable?
Frank pulled up right alongside it. You guys are just racing through the desert, side by side.
Let's go ahead and throw, in this case, let's do the planar warrior benefit of his ranger side. He's going to point out the creature, in this case, just to kind of use some planar magicry on it. And then he's going to attempt to shoot at it using, in this case, Coda. So that's going to be 2d12 plus 12 on the attack roll there. 22. Does that hit?
Sure does.
That'll be 13 force damage against the inevitable.
Mm-hmm.
As Marta sort of yells up to the inevitable,
put down the humans. They don't need to be put at risk for this.
We are bound to service.
Okay, I guess this is his response for now. So
yeah, they work for Harker. So I feel like this is something that's been subtext every time you guys have dealt with this guy. But maybe I should just say it out loud. Like he's a thing that is divinely made to enforce oaths. They are employees. That is a kind of oath. So
yeah, I understand, but.
Yeah, for the audience, maybe they don't know what inevitables are. There's different kinds.
I understand. I'm just, you know, Mardis's MO is right now is just like, despite who they work for, they were still friends of Ed, and they're being put at undue risk right now with the way that this thing's wielding them.
All right, Frank, your turn.
Okay, so I have a thinking. First of all, I can't remember if...
I love when you have a thinking.
I have a thinking. I can't remember. Did I try using lightning on the inevitable the first time we fought it?
I don't think you guys actually ever got into the combat with it. Like, Lenora threw a door.
I just threw it a lot.
So, I know that I couldn't electrocute the cars because rubber tires, they were insulated. Those tires aren't on the ground anymore. I'm wondering, can I electrocute this whole connected thing of cars and inevitable? Because it's no longer insulated. So I'm going to shout out to the two humans in the cars. Look, I'm going to electrocute this thing. You want to get out. You want to get out now. Just get out that car before I do any damage.
How far off the ground are the two cars right now?
So the inevitable is flying at about the top of the car height because Blood Maw's standing on the roof. And it is using each of the cars as, like, gauntlets, basically. So that's where they are. Frank, you yell out, like, I'm going to electrocute them. And Pawn just says, like, the frame of the car is a Faraday cage.
Yeah, they'll be fine inside.
Oh, is that all cars? I don't know how cars work. I thought it was the rubber wheels on the floor was what insulated them. I don't know.
That's a common myth.
Okay, fine. I'm going to electrocute the inevitable. Lightning bolt.
All right, they're very stoic warriors, so they're not great at dex. 12, that's a fail.
Yeah, that's a fail, so I'm going to do my damage roll.
Mm-hmm.
25.
That's not a lot.
Yeah, it's not. The lightning bolt hits the inevitable square in the chest and leaves a burn mark. It hits him with full force because he failed. He takes all 25 damage. That seems like it did something.
No double damage because he's a metal thing.
No, he is properly insulated, being of divine origin.
Okay, that's my turn done, I suppose.
All right, it is the inevitable's turn. He has blood all over his face, so he doesn't quite line up his shots right, but he points both of his arms at the car, and Pond fires up her flamethrower, and Booker fires up the minigun. So we're going to take two. So we need two separate dexterity saving throws. Let's do this. Or no, one's constitution. So, first, constitution saving throw. Everybody?
Oh, butts.
21.
6, no save.
6.
18 with a negative modifier.
Yep, so Blood Maw and Frank save. Mardis and Lenora do not.
Is it half damage or no damage on a save?
Half.
Okay.
All right, so 19 damage for full, 9 for half.
Oh, boy.
It was impossible for Martis to heal the full, even using all of his hit die after the last scenario.
All right, so that's the first one. And then the minigun from Booker. Dexterity saving throw this time.
6.
Fail.
12. Fail.
Fail.
14.
Fail.
Oh, boy.
15?
Yes. So 15 damage, 7 is half.
Okay, so question, Austin. Is her Gatling gun magical?
His? No.
I forgot which one's which.
No, the Gatling gun is not magical.
Cool, then I take half damage because as a demon I have resistance to non-magical weapons.
Yes. So, I actually looked it up. In 5th edition, the kind of demon that Bloodmaw is doesn't, but most of them do. So I just said it in our canon, all demons do. So yes, the car is peppered with minigun and flamethrower, and you guys take some damage. But because the inevitable has blood in its eyes, it has to leave itself open to wipe off its face at the end of its turn. So everybody has advantage against it going forward.
Love it.
Bloodmaw, your turn.
Okay. Bloodmaw is going to take wield up his stop sign and is going to try to cleave this guy in half or just bash him with the concrete part, whichever one works better. So this is 2 attacks with advantage. So the first one's going to be a 15 and the second one will be 16.
Both miss.
Aww.
Yeah, I'm sorry, dude.
It'd been nice if I could have rolled something higher than a 7 in 4 rolls, but... what are you gonna do?
Not great for his first attack as a player character.
I will use my bonus action to go into a rage then.
At the end of your turn?
Yeah, well, I forgot to do it at the start, so. And then I already rolled, so. Oops. Now it's at the start. It doesn't matter. Wouldn't have given me any better shot at hitting.
Okay, so I like this. So Bloodmaw is on top of the car, just swinging wildly with a stop sign at the mechanical angel who's just out of reach. You can't quite reach him.
Quietly under his breath as like the car gets closer, Bloodmaw's just say, blood for the blood god, blood for the blood god, blood for the blood god, blood for the blood god.
Lenora, it's your turn.
All right, I'm gonna try to magnetism him again to the ground. Like smush him to the ground.
Okay, cool. So
19.
29 crit.
Oh, what a little bitch. I fucking hate it.
All right, so you try to throw him into the ground. He's going very fast, so that would have damaged him a lot, but he pulls up. Does not work, and it is Martis's turn.
So we have advantages on our attacks against him?
Correct.
Cool. Same sequence as before, planar warrior to sort of like mark him. 26 on the attack.
Hit.
So that'll be 3d6 plus 6 plus 1d8 force damage. 22 force damage.
Yeah, you just open up. Was that the magic gun?
It is the magic gun, yeah.
Yeah, so you shoot a couple holes in him. That seems like it did very well.
The big thing here, of course, is there's no pair of mage hands that can hold a separate gun, so Martis is forced to only be able to attack once per turn as opposed to twice now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the conduit of synergy was secretly OP. Frank, I think it's your turn.
Can I get the car close enough that I can touch the inevitable from, like, the driver's side window?
You can do whatever you want.
Okay, so Frank's going to pull up so that he can touch it from the driver's side window. And he's going to try and pull off Vampiric Touch. So that's a d20 plus 9.
Uh-huh.
Okay, a 17 and a 20 is the second.
Hit.
Okay, so let's do my damage. Okay, 13 damage.
Yeah. All right, so you pull over and you... because Frank's whole thing with the Vampiric Touch is he has to bite onto the leg of the inevitable.
Yeah, he's maybe because he's driving the car, he's using his hand like a, you know, like a shadow puppet to bite
chomp
onto it. Big chomps with his shadow puppet hand out the window.
Big munch.
All right, nice. Your shadow puppet bites into him and necrotic energy begins to course through his leg and it seems to be damaging the metal. So it actually did damage.
And I recover half of that back as HP nice. As well.
All right, it is the Inevitable's turn, and the Inevitable is going to ram the Losermobile. Just use it's the force of an angel going at, you know, 90 miles per hour with two cars for hands. So strength versus strength. That's actually going to be Frank, because you're the driver. Or vehicle proficiency, which I think is probably about the same for you.
Oh, no, I've got a plus 1 to strength and nothing on vehicle, so...
11?
15!
All right!
Frank's a strong boy.
All right, so the inevitable rams the vehicle. Frank, what do you do? You win.
Frank, with one hand still just gripping onto this inevitable, draining the life, he just holds onto the wheel, turns it completely the opposite way. He's jamming out to the music. This is the best he's ever driven a car.
Bloodmaw, it's your turn. Frank is, has the wheel against the inevitable, which is trying to ram into the car.
Okay. So do we still have advantage?
No.
Then I will use one of my barbarian powers called Reckless Attack. So I'm throwing all concern for defense aside so I can attack with reckless abandon. So I will get advantage on melee weapon attacks, but in turn, I'll take everyone gets advantage to attack me as well.
Oh, sweet. That means I gotta attack Bloodmaw to get sneak attack. Got it.
Oh, no. This is going to be two attacks against it, both with advantage then. So 26 for the first one and 27 for the second one.
Okay, you saved up the bad dice from last time.
They're close enough now.
You hit twice.
28 damage.
Yikes.
Plus 16. Jesus.
Barbarians raid bonuses strength-based attacks while raging, you know?
All right, so you slam your stop sign into his shoulder, and it cracks, and you see that the arm is about to be torn off by the weight of the car that is plunged into. So he's starting to look pretty bad. It's a really good attack. That was a lot of damage.
Tin Can Man will be torn asunder by my rage!
Lenora, your turn.
This might be wild.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm thinking about trying to use magnetism to tear the arm off the rest of the way.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to do that. Yeah?
Mm. Tear it off and throw it at him.
21.
9.
Fuck you, you wimp. Not you, the inevitable.
Uh-huh.
Bye, arm. Bye.
All right. So I didn't establish which weapon this is. Do you want to?
Which one do we hate more, guys? Which one did more damage?
The minigun. The minigun does more damage.
Bye, gun.
All right. So you tear off the arm of the inevitable, which is holding onto Booker's military vehicle. And it gets, shorn off and thrown into the desert storm. It rolls over. It does not explode or anything.
Yeah, so...
You see the what's the word I'm looking for? The airbag. Fuck, I'm so stupid. The airbag goes off as the car rolls off into the storm.
He's fine. He'll be fine.
Ed? Or not Ed. I keep saying Ed. I wrote Ed. That's my fault. Martis, your turn.
Martis will look at the car with a bit of concern before he returns his attention to the inevitable to try to disable it from honestly being more of a threat to Pond than it being a threat to the party. So Planar Warrior to mark it effectively. 27 on the attack roll.
Hits.
2d6 plus 6 plus 1d8. 22
oh my
force
God.
Damage.
Holy snipple snaps. You put a bunch of more holes in it, and once again, it looks like the arm is extremely badly damaged, and he's about to lose that weapon as well. Frank, it's your turn. The inevitable is still trying to tilt the car over, but it's down to one weapon.
Right, so as it's my turn, and this thing is like, it's taken some hits, I'm gonna try and like hope that I can do some cantrips and do something okay. So I'm gonna go for...
Well, remember, Vampiric Touch is still active.
Oh, yeah, Vampiric Touch is still active. Yeah, more Vampiric Touch.
Slurp, slurp.
Yeah, I've got to do... I have to do the roll again, don't I?
Yeah, but you don't lose any more spell slots.
Yes, that is the good point. 21.
Hits.
Another 15 damage.
Paint me a picture.
Okay. Frank is still holding on to this thing with his... Hand of vampirism biting on, and he's just going to try and grab onto one of those arms that's looking like it's about to come off, bite in, and try and pull.
All right, so you guys are doing like an arm tug of war. Frank, you grab it at the part where it's been shot through a couple times, and you begin to pull. You actually see Pond inside of the muscle car. She actually has a gun and goes to aim it at you as you rip the arm off this inevitable. The airbag goes off as Pond's car hits the desert and goes flipping. And the inevitable like slides armless across the desert floor.
So the inevitable that's still just like floating. Can we tell if it's any risk to us anymore?
It doesn't have any arms. Let's say combat's over for now. It's flying with no arms, like a missile through the desert, and it tries to fly in front of the car and push its feet against the front to slow you down. And it's just yelling, "Halt, Oathbreakers!"
Can I leap up and try to cut its head off with the stop sign?
Sure.
I'm going to reckless charge this one, too.
Uh-huh.
So 27 and 32. I don't know how I rolled.
So you rolled a natural 20. So basically you have a 27 and a crit is what you rolled.
Hold up, I crit?
I can't believe you're going to steal Frank's kill again.
I'm not trying to steal his kill. I thought he got the kill. I'm just trying to stop him from pushing our car over.
No, it's a three-phase boss fight. You killed one arm, then the other, then the head.
I had this conversation with Austin before we recorded. I'm pretty sure like the last five or six boss fights, Frank has had the penultimate attack, and then someone else just waltzes in with a really cool finisher.
I didn't mean to steal your kill last time. I just really wanted to kill all the gods.
Oh no, it's cool. I'm just aware that like Frank is support dad. He's in the background like getting Aww. Everything ready, and then it's like, okay, kidnap. Now you go out and kill the big old boss, and you can have the credit. I'll just sit back here. It's all cool.
Like when parents let their kids win like Monopoly and shit.
Exactly. I'm just like, oh no, I accidentally did too little HP. You'll have to finish him off, Bloodmore.
Okay, so he says, stop, halt, Oathbreakers. And Bloodmore, what do you say?
I'm gonna wear your trash can as a helmet!
Okay. You swat his head off with the concrete part of the stop sign. His body falls underneath the loser mobile, which runs it over and mangles it.
Oh, boy.
What?
What is going on? All right. So you guys won that fight.
Bloodmoth's going to like crawl back into the van afterwards.
Uh-huh.
And he's going to, do we ever establish what he wears?
No, he's just kind of a big gorilla. What if a gorilla and an orangutan were smooshed together and they wore,
because my mind, he wears a loincloth.
Yeah, it's like wrestling trunks.
I want him to reach into the loincloth and pull out a sandwich and just start devouring it.
Okay.
That's where he keeps the sandwiches. There's a sandwich pouch.
Mars will comment,
I'm not sure what is less sanitary, your method of fighting or your method of storing sandwiches.
Bloodmaw will offer his sandwich to Martis.
Fortunately, I don't need to eat.
You miss out on delicious mustard of Dijon.
I'm pretty sure that's mustard of something. Whether it's Dijon, I'm not so sure.
Okay. Frank, you successfully drive through the sandstorm. You almost plow into the back of another car because it's so hard to see in the storm. But with a 19, I'm not going to do that to you. You pull up just short, and you find yourself in, like, a car graveyard where everyone who drove out to Valentine's itself basically had to abandon their cars. And there's just, like, a sea of them in here, and a lot of them are mangled and shot up and flipped and crashed into each other. And you pull up at the last second into a skid at the back of this sea of cars. But you can see the shadow, the shape of the Valentine itself. Cities in the distance, and you hear people like yelling, and you hear gunfire and the clash of metal, just people brawling in here.
I'm trying to work out if there's any way we can get, so you said the issue is that we can't get the cars in because the thing's a couple of feet up.
So it's two cities stacked on top of each other floating in the middle of the desert, but it's not floating so high you can just walk up and climb into a tunnel.
Maybe overthink squatting here. I'm wondering if I can tense this floating disc, set it at kind of an angle, maybe create a ramp to get the car up in, to get us in there faster.
I can't, like, Moses fucking parting the Red Sea.
If you want to spend the time to do that, or you guys could just walk in.
I mean, I'm okay with just walking in, but if y'all think we really need the car.
I'm up for just walking in. The car seems impractical. I was, overthink squatting.
Before we head in, Bloodball will turn to Martis and he'll say, where's the other one? The actual robot one.
I can't get him to wake up. I can't find him.
What normally wakes him up? For me, it is good cup of coffee in morning.
Frank does have a spell called Alarm, but I don't think that's quite how it works.
Fucking Chris coming in here and just be like, I'm just gonna have all three of the most beloved characters this season. Fuck y'all.
Yeah.
I'm just nervous because I'm at half health again, practically. And we have no healing in the party anymore.
Yeah, because Frank can't heal again because he's not had a long rest, so he can't use his healing.
And I've used literally all my hit dice, so I have no access to healing.
Well, we will work a solution out when it comes up, I suppose. Right, into the tunnels we go.
All right, so you guys pile out of the Losermobile and work your way through the abandoned car graveyard that has built up around Valentine's itself. The desert winds buffet you. If you got to spend too much time out here, you have to start making rolls to not be damaged as you are abraded by the sandstorm. But you guys can duck in pretty quickly. You see the shadows of people fighting in the desert, just like drunk guys brawling, mercenaries and just common thieves shooting at each other. Most of these people don't bother you if they do notice you because you guys are all big time superheroes. They've seen the videos of you killing a devil with a sword in broad daylight or, killing an assassin robot or throwing dudes out of trains. So most of these common thugs don't mess with you.
One benefit I could point out to the party is since we've been basically traveling for probably more than an hour, the party can't become lost except by magical means at this point. Just because passive ranger shenanigans starts kicking in.
All right, so you guys get close enough to Valentine itself to see it very clearly. The first thing you notice is that it's weirdly desaturated, as if like the color is beginning to run out of it. There was this conversation with Aeron a couple of episodes ago where him and Ed discussed the way that forms are imperfect in this material world. So that comes to mind immediately. You also see it seems like weirdly shimmery and impermanent. There's something weird about it because it is something perfect brought into an imperfect world and it's not supposed to be. So it's gives you a weird feeling, but it's just so enormous. Like it's like seeing like the Grand Canyon in person or something, how overwhelming it is. But you guys see on the sides of it, there's a bunch of tunnels which cut off because in the real world, these tunnels go somewhere else. They don't stop at the city limits, but you guys can crawl into one of them if you want to.
Let's go.
Yeah, crawl in.
Yep.
So in Aaron's initial message about this that he broadcast out, he didn't say anything about the location of this vault. He didn't say specifically it was in the center, did he?
No, he did not. He just said there's a vault with the soul of Valentine, and you get the subtext that part of the experiment is finding it.
Finding it, okay.
So in terms of places we've been, is there anywhere that the party thinks is worth trying first? Because, like, first things that jump to mind for me, Sharp Financial seems like a place that would have vaults already.
A vault,
It's the only place I can think of that would, like, that we have been that would already have a vault.
The only two places I could think of would be Richard Sharp or Solomon's, the manor.
Yeah, I was gonna say, yeah. Like the media headquarters, because he was working with Solomon.
Blood Maw will suggest we go check out the local Schmimmy John's restaurant.
Oh my god.
Okay, so Blood Maw.
Out of character, though, I will note, Aeron, his whole deal is deserving, so what place would be the most deserving place of having the vault is where my logic goes to.
Mm.
Like, where would be a place where the person who's most deserving would be able to find it, or where they'd be shown as the most deserving?
The deserving question, my answer depressingly to, like, where would you put it for the people who deserve it most? Not in Valentine. Because the people running there looking for the vault probably wouldn't deserve it because everyone's being very greedy. I'm like, maybe it's not even in Valentine. Maybe that's the trick. Because no one who's going in there deserves it.
Maybe the vault's in all of us all along. We just need to perform an operation to remove it.
Fuck! He figured it out.
Frank's just going to try shouting up in the tunnel. I have decided not to look for the vault because I am not greedy, and therefore I am the one deserving of the vault. Present to me the vault.
Choose the carpenter's cup, the one that looks plain.
Uh-huh. So the party begins climbing up into the tunnels at the very bottom of South Valentine. And Bloodmaw, as soon as you touch it, you touch this form, the first thing from the world of forms that you've had contact with, you are... What's the word I'm looking for? Your fucking mind explodes, dude.
Oops.
Oh.
You may not know it, but your entire life has already been measured in coins. Every effort, every function, from the time you spend with your eyes tightly shut, watching thin ribbons of blood press against the light, to the water in the tears you have to replace. We pack ourselves with rulers and thermometers, compasses, maps, psychrometers, barometers, pH strips hanging out of our mouths. So concerned we are about our acidity, our iron levels, if we are getting enough antioxidants to avoid those encroaching troublesome toxins. We scribble out charts and diagrams, devour data and advice, suggestions and instructions, struggling to placate this urge to find the perfect numbers that might finally explain what we are or what we are supposed to be doing. We break ourselves down wrestling the world, trying to measure our place, our poetry, our families, our stardom, our legacies. Ghouls in expensive suits stand in swarms in deserts, shoving each other aggressively, yelling out serpentine values, hurriedly shoveling handfuls of sand into their pockets, calculatedly discussing the real estate market and how important it is to own as much land as possible, cautiously eyeing each other, trying not to tip their hand to how invested they are in the hot grains of coarse glass pouring from the small gaps in their pocket linings, biding their time until somebody with money they don't have needs it. People have already determined how much your blood is worth, and they are doing everything they can to come to own it.
So you have the same experience the rest of them did when they were first hooked up to the Ironsoft, as they touched the pure energy of the world of forms, and they became conduits. What is Blood Maw the Invincible a conduit to?
Conduit of Carnage!
Which, I know we had this view. Okay. What does that do?
So for the Conduit of Carnage, Blood Maw can choose to make an attack he hits with into a critical hit, but his target will get an opportunity attack against him should they survive the attack.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a very chaotic sort of move fitting of a demon who shoots blood out of his mouth regularly to entertain people.
And whose whole thing is deliberately injuring himself in brutal ways for the crowd's enjoyment.
Yes.
So you guys climb into the tunnels of South Valentine. Does anybody else even notice? I think Martis, with your perception, you notice that Blood Moss like fucking goes stock still for like 5 seconds as his brain is rearranged. Do you say anything, or do you just like, oh yeah, that guy?
Yeah. That's one of the reasons why sandwiches don't do it for me anymore.
Yes. Desert brain orgasms are best.
Just like a question for us fighting in here. Do we now have to worry about every single low-life thug that has entered Valentine looking for this vault now being a potential conduit user that might pose us a real challenge?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Of course.
Bloodball will roar in primal glory and excitement at that thought.
Back in Valentine, Reese.
Oh, no, I don't want to. No, I want to go back to playing the fun, angry guy.
Reese is in the car with Handsome Chris. I think you transfer the call to your, like, an iPad. You see Alistair looking up at you, very cross. She's in a bathing suit. She's, like, looking through all the news stuff, and she's very cross. She says, "What is going on back there? I leave you in charge, and you take over some companies. I'm very happy that I turned my back in the live streams. Explain yourself."
Well, I mean, we're not affiliated with Aeron Aeronautics, so, I mean, he's a rival company. I think maybe this is what Crown as a whole should have been focused on ultimately, but, you know, the team's going out to get it, so we got it under control. Just like we've gotten everything else under control while you've been gone. How's your vacation? Are my ties good there?
It was going swimmingly until I received this notification.
I'll just forget about that.
How many water slides did she go down?
Three! They were just delightful. What? And the handsome Chris is in the front seat like, dude, now's the time. Just tell her.
So Reese will use her conduit of art power, and she's going to create like a bedazzled gavel on it that says best judge. And she's going to show it to Alistair and say, we got this for you because you're the best judge. It's the best gavel that's ever been made. And it's also, you know, a retirement gift for you.
Oh.
Excuse me?
Well, yeah, I mean, it seems like you really enjoy vacation a lot and you don't want to deal with all the undue stress. So we figured we could, you know, give you the best send-off package possible. You know, not cut any corners.
What's the meaning of this?
It's a sweet-ass gavel for you to have, so you can, you know, put it up in your luxury condo over wherever you are now. We'll buy it for you, of course.
Smarta.
Yeah, and Smarta. We'll buy you that condo in Smarta you've always been thinking of. Your severance package will cover it.
Handsome Chris, pull over immediately and get this ex-employee out of my vehicle.
I'm going to give Handsome Chris a five to not do that. A big old fiver.
Uh-huh. Handsome Chris takes your five, and he says, actually, Your Honor, if you read the updates that Ed sent out in the contracts, we own the company now, and you don't, so...
Woo!
That was a long payoff there, but worth it.
You got like a 39 in that skill check, my dude.
Listen, I got the best contract writers in the company to draft those clauses to make them airtight.
So Alistair says, so you just expect me to take this gavel and move to a condo in Shmorida and just leave Valentine and let you yahoos take over?
Yep. Bye, Felicia. And I'm going to hang up.
All right. Cool. Back in Valentine itself, the party, you guys have been trudging through the tunnels. We cut away because there was some boring tunnel walking. However, in the meantime, you guys have been infused with the power of the world of forms. Just you get in touch with your pure form. For Lenora, that's magnetism.
Mm-hmm.
Frank, protection. Bloodmaw's carnage. And part of, you know, Ed's chassis is synergy. Mm-hmm. And all of you are healed to full health and get all of your spell slots back.
Oh, thank you.
Hey.
Pokemon Center.
Does my Nox Rage get refilled?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
One of the things I was curious about, like, with respect to that, is like, what does Martis himself basically feel with respect to this? Is it just like how he normally feels day to day, or what?
You know? I mean, Martis is himself already. He doesn't need to be a conduit because he just is already the thing.
Right.
But I imagine there is a feeling of like, I was going to say comfort. That's what my brain wanted to say. But I think maybe is feeling even the right word anymore? I feel like he has reached a thing where feeling is like too low.
Well, yeah, one of the whole ideas I was thinking of with respect to him becoming a form, as you sort of allude, is that essentially, like, there's so many concepts regarding sensory experience, cognition, yada, 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 that are almost illogical to even talk about because it just, you know, it's a different, it's a whole different tier. It's like the senses are more pure and perfect than normal. So,
yeah, it's not even, it wouldn't even be correct to talk about them as senses. Like, you feel like the Buddha in meditation.
I would say that the sensation is oddly familiar, or oddly like the sensation is oddly familiar and comforting to him in the standpoint that it feels like he is communing with the natural plane of existence that he's supposed to belong in, right?
Yeah.
Because basically, as long as he's remembered being a form, he's always been in the material plane inside of this chassis, so...
Yeah, so this is the most at peace Martis has felt in his memory.
Mm-hmm.
So as you guys are trudging through these tunnels, it's dark. There is, like, you know, hear gunfire in the distance and yelling. It's almost like a riot kind of atmosphere. You all have phones, so you can kind of like light your way ahead of you, but it's still pretty dark. And so it takes you a bit by surprise when one of you steps on something hard, and you hear a crunch.
What about dark vision?
But it's dark, but we're dealing with darkness itself, so no, your dark vision won't work.
Oh, okay, yeah, fair, got me.
Unless you have dark vision itself.
Itself.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, there we go.
You're fine. I didn't spring a trap on you. You step on something metal, and you look down, and you see that the floor is changing. As the material world influences this formerly perfect thing, it starts taking on its impurities. And so what you see is that the floor, which was once just a dirt tunnel, is beginning to take on the shape of a mass grave of dead warforged.
Oh, that's fun.
So as you guys watch, like, the floor change, like, morphs, polymorphs almost, to take on that shape as you guys trudge through it.
Cool.
I suppose that is what the city was built on to begin with, wasn't it?
Ding, ding, ding. That's what's happening. In the distance, you guys hear the sounds of people dying.
I want to
see how they're dying. Like, what's happening? Well, I mean, like, are they just spontaneously dying, or are people killing them, or what?
No, it's like fights, right?
Yes, it's fights. Bloodmaw, you run up ahead a little bit to look around the corner of a tunnel, and you see that the geography of this place is changing. Like, this is the fucking worst thing I've ever said on this show, but it's very much like Hogwarts. You know how the Hogwarts is constantly changing inside?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, it's extremely 2018 to make bad Harry Potter analogies, but this actual city is like shifting as of all of the imperfect things about it become material. So you peek around this tunnel, and instead of seeing like the subway station or what should be here, you see an enormous room that is all one wrestling ring. And there are dead bodies just strewn about inside of it.
Is there a living person inside this wrestling ring? My wrestling ring?
There's a lot. And yeah, the remaining living people are killing other people and, you know, finishing off dead bodies. Like, a fight just happened here and someone won.
Not in my ring, they're not.
Oh, God.
Bloodmaw, you run into the ring?
Yes.
So you run out of the tunnel and into the wrestling ring, which shouldn't be here, but King Coliseum is an important location in South Valentine. It's where people go to get some escape from the real world, to imagine a world in which good guys can win against evil guys and where strength and skill matter. And as you walk up to the ropes of what is, like, a full-sized room instead of just a wrestling ring, you see who just won the fight in here, which is a bunch of warforged in the shape of thorny devil lizard folk.
Oh.
I liked that reaction. There are four of them, and you see one of them has a enormous revolver with a burn mark on the side of it.
Oh, I know that dude. I want to break him.
I know that dude. I want to break him.
Yeah.
All right. So the other three,
Is that Mechagodzilla?
Yes, it is Mechagodzilla. It's a warforged lizard.
So much work and tension be built into the scene, and I lost all of it the moment I saw Mechagodzilla enter the D20.
I just love that Austin puts this work in for, like, things that only are for us. Our little moment.
Oh.
The important thing is that all of you are enjoying yourselves.
I'm going to break all these Godzillas.
All right, so these things are all the kind of young Solomon Luna form. They're all thorny devil lizards, but instead of being 3D printed out of organics, they were built as warforged. And you also see that they all have pithing needles in their palms, which they are using to finish off the ruffians they just killed in the ring, except for the one who has the authorization, Katarina's old revolver, which was on her when she died and fell into Solomon Luna's hands.
That's fucking rude.
So what do you guys say as you walk up? I assume, like, Bloodmaw just jumps over the ropes and is like, I'm going to break you.
Yeah, Bloodmaw, I mean, I'll let other people say things, because Bloodmaw's running straight towards us and then stop signing somebody in the face. Like, this is a Royal Rumble at this point.
Frank is going to attempt to shout at the one that's got the gun. Where on earth did you get that?
You call that a gun? This is a gun. Let's see which one of us knows how to use it better.
So I'm going to call the one with the gun the Ash Forged, is what I'm going to call it. It's the Ash Forged. It's a war forge that was made out of Solomon Luna's memories and ashes. Because if you'll recall, Ash lost an arm, which had data in it that Aeron wanted to study. And that ended up with Katarina. It's a whole thing.
Remind me. Were these Warforged squishy to lightning?
So actually, normal Warforged aren't, so Ed is not.
Okay, was Ed lightning squishy? Ash?
I would assume not.
No. I like where your head's at. But if you'll recall, Katarina died with part of Ash's arm on her, the other part she gave to Aeron to study because it had data in it. So when Katarina died, Solomon took the arm, got the memories out of there, and then did the same thing he did with Katarina, which was make Katarina-Solomon hybrids. This is a Solomon-Ash hybrid. All of them have Ash's pithing needle arms, and he gave the pistol to one of the revolver to one of them. Are there any questions about this plot development?
Can I break the one's face with my stop sign, please?
Yes, you can absolutely break the one's face. Was there... Someone asked a question. I think, Frank, you asked where they got the pistol from, right?
Yeah. I was asking in character just in a sort of like, are you likely to respond to me or are you just going to ignore that I've questioned?
The Ashforge responds to you and it says,
there is always a chance that you would kill Luna. The algorithm allowed for that and we were sent ahead. It was lucky that Aeron brought Luna in on his experiment.
Well, what about the potentiality that we also kick your ass here? You think about that bit?
The algorithm cannot predict where the bullets will land, only what choices you'll make.
Well, I'll make
Doesn't predict where the stop sign goes! And I rolled a crit.
Alright, so do you want to hit the one with the gun?
Yes.
Alright, so... Oh, you rolled a crit. God damn, dude!
Roll double damage dice, do it. Do it.
So I didn't rage before this, but I will still deal 16 damage.
All right, you just crack the Ash Forged across the face with the stop sign. Roll initiative, everybody.
Initiative time.
6.
28.
Crit fail.
10.
So, Martis, you're first. You're fighting. There's 4 Warforged, just like Ed, with the memories of the person who almost killed him several times.
I guess what I'll do is, gun is already drawn, so we'll use a minor. We'll use a bonus action to slap a hunter's mark on the forge that has been hit already by Bloodmaw.
Mm-hmm.
Line up and take a shot against it. Since I'm acting before it has a chance to act, I get advantage in the attack roll. 24.
Yep.
All right, that'll be 4d6 plus 6 damage, 23 damage.
Yikes.
Yeah, he's just like, the gun is sort of like down by his side, just lifts it up and just like pulls the trigger immediately. And that's the opener for Martis there.
All right, it is now enemy's turn. So basically what happens is these 4 Warforged were just killing off a bunch of people who came here for whatever's in the vault. They saw you rolling in, Bloodmaw ran up and just started wailing on people. And then without saying much of anything, you just shot him in the head. As a response... The Ash Forged with the gun is going to activate his conduit power, the conduit of cruelty, the inverse of the conduit of mercy that Ash had.
Well, the conduit of cruelty. What is it? Oh,
yeah. All right. Which is he can make an attack when he makes an attack. He can make an attack against all of his enemies. So attack.
Oh, that bitch.
10 against everybody.
Suck it. Didn't hit.
That's a miss.
That's a miss against everybody. So yeah, he does like a fanning the hammer on the authorization revolver as he shoots everybody in a quick flurry, but you guys either tank it through your armor or it misses. And then the other two are going to rush forward and start stabbing Bloodmaw. Bloodmaw, 13, 18, botch.
18 will hit.
All right, so the 18 is going to do 5 damage, and the botch is going to open himself up to an attack. So you can attack him.
Sweet. 19.
Hit.
Fuck yeah. Just you wait till I start raging too. 7 damage.
All right, so you wail on another one, and it is... My notes are bad. It is Bloodmaw's turn. Bloodmaw, one of the guys just ran forward with his, you know, palm pithing needle and tried to stab you, and you just wailed on him, and now you can hit him again if you want.
I could, or I could hit the one with the gun.
Mm-hmm.
I really want to hit the one with the gun. He brought such a coward's weapon to this, to fist fight and stop sign fight.
So. Yeah, he brought it to this fight, not the other way around.
Exactly. So I'm going to use a bonus action to go into a rage. And then it's stupid to do the reckless attack. So I'm just going to go with 2 attacks onto the guy with the gun, to the Ash Forged. So 17 and 12.
17 hits.
I'm going to turn that one into a crit. Let's carnage this shit up. So I'm going to turn that one into a crit.
Mm-hmm.
And if he survives, then he'll get to do his attack against me then. So I have one feature as well that lets me re-roll a weapon damage dice if I don't like it. And I don't like that too. So I'm going to re-roll that. Yeah, that's better. So that's going to be 22 instead. 22 damage.
All right. So you bring down the concrete end of the stop sign on top of the Ash Forged's head, crushing it down into his torso. And with the last life inside of this automaton, it tosses the gun to another Ash Forged.
I like crunch.
Don't we all? Frank, it's your turn. There are 3 Ash Forged left.
Okay. Are they all within about 5 feet of each other?
Yeah, the main brawl is happening in the center of this wrestling ring that shouldn't be here.
Okay, I want to try and aim a lightning bolt so that it's 100 foot by 5 foot line gets the three Ash Forged and not any of our party, ideally.
Yeah, so you can hit, let's say you can hit 2 or you can hit 3 and Bloodmaw.
Okay, let's go 2, let's go 2.
All right, so they made a dexterity saving throw?
Yep, dex save.
19.
Well, then that's half damage, I suppose. Okay, 33 was the roll, so you take half of that.
16.
Yeah, 16. The one time I actually get a good roll on that lightning.
2 of them take 16 damage, which is actually really bad. So they take, a bunch of burns, and they are seriously injured. And it is Lenora's turn.
I want to rage. I'm going to rage, first of all. And then I'm going to use my magnetism power to take the gun, hopefully.
All right.
21 with advantage.
Jesus. 11. All right. So you yank the authorization out of the Ash Ford's hands and it flies over to you?
Yeah, mine now.
All right. That's cool. What do you do with it?
Can I shoot him?
You sure can.
What do I roll to shoot?
Dexterity plus proficiency plus 3.
Okay. All right. That is...
Plus 3 magic weapon there, huh?
Yeah, it has been upgraded off screen by Solomon, who put all of his hopes on this team getting to the vault.
22.
It's 2d8 damage. So in this case, the damage would be 2d8 plus dexterity plus 3 for the damage.
16.
Lenora, you suck the gun out of one of the Ash Ford's hands. It flies into your palm. You just turn it around and you blow his head clean off.
Nice.
That was one of the ones that Frank hit with the lightning bolt, so...
Bloodmaw gives you an approving thumbs up.
Thanks, buddy.
All right, now Lenora's got a gun. That went well last time.
I thought you said no guns.
Listen here. It's called growth.
Is this growth?
Martis, it's your turn.
The first one with the gun that he had sort of marked is already dead, right?
Correct.
All right, so he's going to use his bonus action to relocate the mark onto one of the remaining... 2 that are standing or 3 that are standing?
2. One is badly burned by the lightning and one is not.
He's going to relocate it to the one with the lightning. line up and take a shot at it. There's no one adjacent to it, so... but it's a crit anyway.
Oh, my lord.
So that's gonna be... That's still gonna be 6d6 plus 6.
Oh, my God.
33 damage.
Why don't you tell me what happens?
Like, it's one of those... You ever play Killer 7?
Yeah, a long time ago.
Okay, so just, like, the idea of, like... Like, since Martis, as fans of Season 3 might remember, was one of the first people to use guns, like, while he does not have the benefit of having the extra pair of guns, the fact that he's sort of been forced to kind of be in this situation has allowed him to get back to sort of his natural self. So I just sort of... He sees one go down, he sees one hit by lightning, he just sort of, like... aims the gun over, glances, and just pulls the trigger, like, as if it's nothing, as the bullet just slams straight into the face of the Ashbot, and it just falls over with a grand spark arcing from its face where the bullet impacts.
All right, there is only one left in this wrestling ring, and it retracts its pithing needle and says,
"Is this really what you want? To snuff out the last chance of a world with gods?"
If it's my turn, I'm attacking him.
That is a perfectly legitimate answer to that question.
I'm leaving space for other people to say anything, but as Blood Maw, it's suplex city time.
Martis can reply.
If the type of god you want to keep is the one that Solomon was based on, that's a god that's better off dead.
I don't know what's in the vault, but Aeron promised that I could bring back an era of gods.
Then it better be brought back by someone who knows what the gods were really like. And it's certainly not you.
So I was right all along. You just needed a little push. I knew you would save us all, Ed.
Ed is dead for now. I want to bring him back. And if I can bring him back... by whatever's in that vault, then I'm gonna do it. But right now, you're in my way, and I think someone's got something to say to you.
And then there's the finger guns over the Blood Maw.
Crunch City, bitch! Crunch, crunch City, bitch!
And I'm going to...
Oh, I thought I was gonna imagine it like that picture with Henry Cavill and fucking Jason Momoa, where he's like...
Well, the first one's gonna be a crit. I'm using Reckless Attack, by the way. So, the first one's a crit, and I'm going to use... the conduit of carnage on the second one to do a double crit.
All right, so I'm
all right. Well, I want to roll the damage for this just for shits and giggles.
Okay,
it's 36, and you know what? I don't like one of those threes, so I'm gonna re-roll that one into something better. So it's an 11 now. So it's a 44 instead, and I'm going to basically like. Slam him, like crunch him a little bit with the end of the stop sign, and then I'm gonna drop the stop sign, pick him up over my shoulders. Actually, no, I'm gonna choke slam him instead. So I'm gonna grab his throat, and I'm just gonna like squeeze it like it's crunching like a can, and I'm gonna lift him up and choke slam into the ground. And when he hits the ground of the mat, he just explodes.
Okay.
And then Blood Maw will raise his hands up, and then bring them down, and fire will shoot out of the ring posts.
All right.
And then he will say to the corpse, "Welcome to Crunch City!"
All right, so you've killed the last person in the wrestling arena. You still hear fighting behind you and in the distance. There's like the double doors outside of the arena that weren't there before you killed these Ashforged, which is weird. But you can hear the sound of fighting on the other side of the door.
I mean, more blood for the blood god. So I'm going to check it out.
Yeah, let's open the door.
By the way, Blood God's me. When I say that, I'm referring to Blood Maw.
Okay. So people start leaving the ring to go open the doors. As you do, the last person out, Martis, you hear a voice from one of the Ashforged who's not quite dead. And you hear it kind of whisper.
"I'm sorry, Ed."
"What are you sorry for?"
Before it can answer, the last life goes out of it, and it is still.
"Yeah. I'm sorry, too. I'll try to make it right for the both of us. For all three of us.
The party opens the double doors outside of the ring, and you find yourself looking down an alleyway. Like a dark, dank alleyway in the slums of South Valentine that should not be here.
Are we going to the Oak and Holly?
All right, we proceed down the alleyway.
All right, so you guys start walking down this dank alleyway, and there's just like garbage and like...
How dank is this alleyway?
It's extremely dank, 420.
I'm dabbing all the way down the alleyway.
Okay. Let's just say it's assumed that anytime Bloodmaw is not speaking, he's dabbing furiously.
Or eating and dabbing.
Or eating blunts.
Yep.
That's okay. So you guys walk down this dark alleyway, and you've never been in this part of the city. It's probably not even a real part of the city. It just represents part of the city. And as you exit the alleyway, instead of going onto like the street where alleyways normally go to, you end up in the middle of the dance floor of the Oak and Holly nightclub.
I knew it.
And the club is pumping. And there's like strobing lights, and it's like popping off as if it's the middle of a very busy night, but there's only one person on the dance floor.
Who it be?
Private Fortune.
Ah, I didn't know it, but I should have known it.
He has a rocket launcher.
Damn, I'm be like, yes!
You believe it's morning, I'm alive, but that's the last thing on my mind. Do you believe it's morning, I'm alive, but that's the last thing on my mind.
Yeah, see, I'm in the street struggling. Young, dumb, and thuggin', give a fuck about nothing. Stuck at rock bottom, trying to come up on something. Pumping from
Lauren.
Austin.
Credits.
Love to credit.
August 2018.
God damn, it's already more than halfway through the year. What the fuck?
You're welcome.
Please, no.
I did it. I'm taking credit. Also, credits, music. For August 2018, we have a Overclocked remix, Geofractura, an arrangement of Fault Zone from Echo the Dolphin, The Tides of Time.
I love Echo the Dolphin.
I do love Echo the Dolphin, too.
It's so hard.
It's impossible, actually. Also, Cream, Phonics remix by the Wu-Tang Clan, and Back in the Game, the Phonics remix by the Wu-Tang Clan. Of course, everyone knows this season's all about the cash. And now it's almost over. We're at the end. Are you excited?
I'm excited. Like every season, it's like, oh, this is too much. Time for casual laughing with buds for the first couple episodes. But mm-hmm. I also miss my characters at the end of every season, so it's like mm-hmm. bittersweet.
Lenora is very good. Very, yes, your most OC of OCs, but also the highest body count. So I'm keeping an eye on you.
I'm just a marshmallow.
Uh-huh. All right, executive producers for August. It's a weird month, A, because Patreon had a bunch of updates and stuff, and a bunch of the credit cards got canceled. So if you're not on the list, I apologize.
Fuck you, Patreon.
I promise it was not my fault, but I have the list they have garnished me with. It's also in alphabetical order for the first time that I'm aware of. So that's another fun little wrinkle. You want to start reading them?
Executive producers for August 2018 are A Flaming Horse's Patoot,
Aki Savalainen,
Albert West,
Andrew Birmingham,
Andrew Fallu, Conduit of Mediocrity Itself,
Andrew Grothin,
Anna
Michael,
Anthony Sever,
Arjun Nakoning,
Arna Helgadotir,
Artemis BJJ Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu in Bristol,
August Rue,
Bloody Roar Needs Pangolins, it does.
I also need pangolins. Brady Warner.
Fuck. Brent, according to all known laws of aviation, there's no way a bee, and then it cuts off because you ran out of characters, you sadistic bastard.
I want to know what the bee can't do.
It's the script of B movie. It's the first line of the script of B movie.
I've never seen that, and I will continue to do that.
Okay, continuing.
Cameron Abbas.
Carter Rayner.
Christopher Charlow.
Cody Jackson.
Counterfeith.
Daniel Stashik.
Don.
Dennis Bangston.
Dennis Pancake Detlefson.
Devin Smith.
Douglas Williamson.
Dr. Tao.
Dr. Goatman.
There's a lot of doctors. I've got a very well-read. Some of our listeners are geniuses, and some of them love B-movie.
Damn. Getting Brent.
Dylan.
Einar Johansson.
Ikorin.
Elderly Goose.
Eleanor Nonante sees Periton.
Aline.
No, it's Aline!
Aline!
Andiga Van Dane.
Erwan Lilagadek.
I think that sounds like a hero from Celtish folklore.
It does.
Exos.
Exilaris.
Five Purple Wands.
Florian H.
You have to say Florian H. Finger guns, finger guns, finger guns. You have to hear the finger guns.
I'm getting so dunked on this morning. I didn't even fuck anything up, I don't think, yet.
Francois V.
Garrett.
Grimlock.
Harley Astor.
Harrison Andrew.
Hedron Master.
Hustle Bones.
I'm a pretty kitty full of snuggles and violence.
Aren't they all?
Yeah.
Ingmar Grimmon.
Ionis Soy My Name. Love it. Nicolopoulos.
Isaac Arevalo.
Jack Clow. Like the Clow cards?
Jadakins, and then an ASCII picture of a dick.
Dick.
I saw it coming a mile away and it still got me somehow.
James Neely.
Janiac, form of tripping your face off.
Wow, big mood.
Mm-hmm.
Jaspel Singh.
J. Logan, conduit of queerness itself.
Mm. Jeff Clark.
Jerry, herself.
Jesse Young.
Joaquin Groening.
John Potts.
John Barnett.
Joseph Tombrello.
Josh Mosier.
Joy Fox.
Jewman Jack.
Julian Phillips.
Junk 2.0.
Just the Jester.
Justin Berthasel. Conduit of ooh itself.
Big same.
Now that totally puts to bed the theory that it's supposed to be a face. Because how would I pronounce it if it was a face? It's ooh woo.
Ooh woo. It's a face and an emotion.
Uh huh.
Jorgen, conduit of name butchering Winework Ford.
Caster UK.
Kiefer Lowe.
Ken Fursell.
Kevin Dobbins.
Killer Cotton Shizno.
Kitty Foe.
Criterion.
Lana Seawolf.
Lass Cruz.
Levy, the young continent of not mad, just disappointed.
Oh. Oh, we've all been there. Yeah. Lindsay Pankhurst.
Lauren Cates.
Luke Powers.
Joe.
You looked at that and you said Joe and not M. Joe as if it was the initial first name.
I thought it would be funny.
Oh, Madison Lilith McKenzie.
Major Tim.
A Cult of Orphanax.
Matthew B. Hare.
Matthew Weber.
Matthew Lackett.
Majin.
Melissa Booker.
Melissa Nielsen.
Mal Teach.
Marissa Donaldson.
Michael Hall.
Miko from Finland.
Morgan Rapp.
Nicholas Dominic.
Niels June Ina Joret. I'm so sorry.
Noah Sudret.
Notorious Stoltz.
Paul Mullen.
Possum Kingdom Refugee, come to my house.
No, we need to go to the Possum Kingdom.
That's true. I do love the Possum. But why are they refugees? Is it a terrible kingdom?
It's too much food.
Oh, they love their garbage.
Primordial Orc.
Pruitt Holcomb.
Puck.
Quench the Void.
Random Web Person.
Razumi Yazura.
Rainier, the conduit of being stoned.
No, that's me. Robert Dakin.
Ryan Brown.
Salad Child.
Samantha is meing in Tallahassee rain. I don't know what that means.
Samantha, are you here?
What are you doing?
Oh no.
Samantha.
Seraph Stone.
Scott Cummings.
Scotty Vilhard.
Sean Lyons Burke.
Sean, the host of Funk Dunk Plays.
Savard Nakrasimova.
Starlight Glimmer did nothing wrong.
Stay tuned.
Sweaty Cucumber.
Just a little status update on the Cucumber. Sydney Marzing.
The cast of Dungeons the Gathering.
The Elder Scrolls 5 Skyrim Podcast Credits Edition. See, they said they've ported it to every platform, but now it's true. It wasn't true until it was in a podcast credits. Oh. Thank you.
Oh no, the ghost of Professor Blackwood.
You know I had to do it to him. The Hadsels.
The most wise guru.
Paladin's wife.
Toby Gleason Stack.
Toshir Kuru.
Shanus.
Vigor Arnston.
Victoria Melito.
Vizzy Huggles.
Wayne Hodgins. Birthday July 30th. Dang, happy birthday, bro.
Just snuck a little birthday wish in there for yourself. That's fun. Ziphasaurus.
Yam!
Z 23,619. You didn't like the way I did it last time. How did you like it that time?
Jean Valjean's number in Les Mis is 2. No, wait. I thought it was... Never mind.
Oh, no. You thought you had a reference and it's not the right reference.
Oh, God. No, my brain did a bad.
I literally thought this... Now that we're far enough into it, I can reveal. I thought this was going to be the Les Mis season. I literally thought that it was just going to be like barricades in the street at some point.
Do you hear the Sneeple sing? Yeah.
Yeah. All right. What else do we do at this part?
We talk about animals.
Oh, no. Sketch.bandcamp.
Yeah, sketch.bandcamp. Sketch.bandcamp.
Bandcamp. Bandcamp.
I can't word.
Chris Larios at patreon.com/weeklymongerrecap. That's where he weekly monger recaps. Laura, kotaku.co.uk. Lauren, Rargalicious on Twitter.
Oh, that's me.
That is you. I am patreon.com/austinyorski. As I said, Patreon's being weird, so help. Please help. I'm dying. We're all dying, but
dying.
I'm double dying now because the website did bad. What else? Anywhere on Podbean, Google Play, YouTube. We're probably places I don't even know, but if you just do the things that you're allowed to do there, just click all around. Just click on stuff, see what feels right. I don't know. Algorithms?
Yeah, love to click.
You gotta click, really. That's it, right?
Yeah. Thanks to all the cats and dogs listening.
Mm-hmm.
Love you guys.
I met a new cat recently.
Yeah, you're like obsessed with her and you hate my cats all of a sudden.
Her name's Penelope and she's a princess and your cats are goblins.
Fuck off!
Your cats are goblins. Penelope is a perfect lady, a princess, a queen. I stand for this queen.
You're a goblin!
Got you in bed with a goblin. Kissing goblins?
Kissing goblins.
Goblin vomit.